my heart and my portion forever. This is his word for us. Amen. I will now invite Deacon Justin Chu to representatively pray on behalf of our worship service.
Father, may our praise and worship be pleasing to you today. If our hearts lack praise, we know that the stones will cry out and not let your name go unpraised. Our hearts may be cold, but move our hearts because you can. Don't let us remain stiff-necked, for you're good, righteous, loving, kind, deserving of our praise. You've shown us, and yet we doubt. Merciful Father, please forgive us sins, those sins towards which we might feel apathy because they are so familiar and so constantly repetitive. Have pity on us as we continue to struggle with our pride, believing that we are in control. We don't need more knowledge. Help us to renew the joy of our first love with you, and allow that joy and trust to melt away our intellectual doubts and hurdles. Many of us have tired of waiting for the bridegroom, and we are now chasing the shiny things. Help us to see that the glitter, the smartness, the logic of the world is all foolishness compared to you. You've already ran the million miles towards us. Give us the courage to take the one step and fall in your arms. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Let's worship the Lord together.
I will bless.
Praise God. Amen. You may be seated. I invite the church now to reflectively read with me the Westminster Catechisms to guide us in our confessions before the Lord. I will read the questions and the congregation will read the answers together out loud. Question 79. What is the 10th commandment? You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife or his manservant or maidservant, his ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. Question 80. What does the 10th commandment require? It requires us to be completely satisfied with our own status in life and to have a proper, loving attitude towards others and their possessions. Question 81. What does the 10th commandment forbid? It forbids any dissatisfaction with what belongs to us, envy or grief at the success of others, and all improper desire for anything that belongs to someone else. Brothers and sisters, let us now pray this corporate confession unto God together. Lord, complaints and discontentment frequently rule over our lives. We often envy our neighbor's appearances, accomplishments, and assets. Our hearts lack deep gratitude to you and satisfaction in you. Father, we lack nothing, for Christ is ours forevermore. So how could we covet and demand more from you? You are more than sufficient for us. Help us to rejoice and be glad in you. In Christ's name, amen. Let us now spend some time in personal prayer of confession to God. Let us repent specifically and tangibly in our personal repentance. Let us pray. Brothers and sisters, let us hear the assurance of forgiveness and the promise of restoration that our God offers to us through the gospel from Ephesians chapter 2, verses 4 to 7. But God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace in kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. Church, be encouraged, because despite our shortcomings and blindness, our God assures us with these truths. So let's lift up our hearts of reassurance to the Lord's Prayer that Christ Jesus taught us. Let us now pray together with one voice, the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us rise from our seats again and continue to sing unto God in repentance and in assurance of his truth.
That God has numbered, I was made to walk with.
Let's give the Lord praise. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much, Lord, that though our seasons and our lives can change, that you are the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. Certainly, Lord, you are not only just a sure foundation, you are surely our great reward. We thank you. We love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may have a seat. Church, we will now continue to worship God as we give our offerings to the Lord. If you would like to give an offering, you may either use the link given in the description of our YouTube live stream or visit ec.kcpc.org and click on Giving on the menu so that you may give online. And let's now also give the offering of our lives onto our God through prayer. Let's take a few moments to tangibly commit our upcoming week to serve and love our God. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, please forgive us for not being able to see how you have given to us the riches of heaven in Jesus Christ. Lord, oftentimes we forget all that you have given to us, not just material goods, but your very presence. And so, Lord, as we offer up our offerings to you, may it not just be done without thought, without remembrance of the gospel of Jesus. We pray, Father God, that this offering will bear great fruit to magnify not our names, but the name of Jesus in this world. We thank you, Lord. We love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us again rise from our seats for our scripture reading. Our scripture reading today comes from James chapter 1, verses 9 to 18. Let the lowly brother boast in his exaltation, and the rich in his humiliation, because like a flower of the grass, he will pass away. For the sun rises with its scorching heat and withers the grass. Its flower falls and its beauty perishes. So also will the rich man fade away in the midst of his pursuits. Blessed is the man who remains steadfast under trial, for when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life, which God has promised to those who love him. Let no one say when he is tempted, I am being tempted by God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, and he himself tempts no one. But each person is tempted when he is lured and enticed by his own desire. Then desire, when it has conceived, gives birth to sin, and sin, when it is fully grown, brings forth death. Do not be deceived, my beloved brothers. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. Of his own he will brought us forth by the word of truth, that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creatures. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You may have a seat.
Good morning, KCPC. How are you doing? Good. I have two questions I want you to ask one another. Number one is, are you happy? Ask the person next to you, are you happy? And the second question I want you to ask is, if you are, why are you happy? Yeah, this is going to take months to talk about, so if you're actually getting into substantive answers, I pray that you would wait until the end of the sermon. But let's pray. Let's pray and approach the Lord with a proper attitude. And we'll start from there. Father, when we approach you, we are aware that we are approaching the truth, the standard by which we are to live and called to. And today's word promises that there is no variation or change within you, Father, and your steadfastness is a foundation of how we approach you today. Let your word speak to us, Father. It will have numerous implications for our lives because you meant the book of James to be extremely practical and yet founded upon the gospel. So, Father, I pray that you would cloak your people with practical wisdom today, especially in the area of contentment, for we need to be satisfied in you, for the world to know that we are your disciples, your church, and for your glory. So, Father, be with us in today's word. Man's word cannot change, but your word in fire through the Holy Spirit can change us from the inside out. And so, Father, we humble ourselves. We lower our standards of what we think life should be like, and we are open to your standards being applied to us. Father, thank you. May everyone who needs to hear today's word hear it and be blessed. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. When I was in college, there was a rock climbing board we went to for a retreat. And I made it to about two rocks until the finish line, and I couldn't go up anymore. And it was a really embarrassing moment for my life. I don't know why I didn't make it. Not enough strength, upper body strength, lower body strength. And I remember being lowered down by the rope, and I was like, oh, man. And I was fascinated with rock climbing afterwards. I don't know how people do free climbing without any ropes or suspensions. And so I looked into rock climbing with the suspensions, and I learned some new terms. I want you to really listen carefully to this because this sets the background for our sermon today. So when the person goes up in front of you, up on the cliff, he is called the lead. He is leading the people, and what his role is to find out a good way to go up, a strategy, finding the right places to put the anchors in so that the rope can fall down and support the whole team. And so he's finding ways up the path of the cliff. Now, every now and then, he will find a point where he will connect the rope to the rock. And this is called an anchor. Let's take a look at the picture. This is called an anchor. It's where you're able to put enough gadgets into the rock to hold your team and is strong enough. And this keeps you from falling beyond that point. Now, two words that they use is that they use the word sketchy and bomber. Sketchy and bomber. And so sketchy anchor means that this is an anchor that you shouldn't trust upon. It won't hold your full weight, and so be aware of that as you climb. But this is the best we got right now. And another term is bomber or bomb-proof. This is the type of anchor or the place that is strong enough to sustain your whole weight, your whole body, so you can lean on it, you can hang on it as you're eating, and you can even sleep in it. And so there is a sketchy anchor and a bomb-proof anchor as you're climbing up this hill. Now, just like rock climbing, the issue of satisfaction and happiness and contentment is also like rock climbing. You're moving. What your whole goal is to move from insecure anchors to secure anchors. There were things that were never meant to hold your hope or your happiness or the weight of your expectations. And there are things that are promised to be able to be strong enough to hold your weight as you move on in life. Now, how happy are we today? There is a Gallup poll done in 2022. I just printed a summary of it. And if you look at the picture there, it shows how happy we are. And there are, I think, about 9 areas that people use to measure, and there's subcategories under these to measure how happy you are. And overall quality of life, 69% are satisfied, 38% are dissatisfied, and it gets worse and worse as you go down. The opportunity for a person to get ahead in life, the influence of an organized religion, the size and power of the federal government, the way of income and wealth are distributed in the U.S., our system or government, how well it works, the size and influence of major corporations, and the area that all of us are most unhappy about, 70% of us are unhappy about this, 78%, is the moral and ethical climate of today. There's a separate study done by also an equally authoritative group. It says that there's a COVID response tracking survey, and it's saying that we are the unhappiest generation since 50 years ago, the most unhappy. 14% of us were very happy in 2020, and even just in 2018, 31% of us were happy. And I want to ask you why. The biggest reason that we are unhappy right now because is that all these things that they even look to as criteria, like how the government works, the size of corporations and religions, and what the moral ethical climate of today is, these are sketchy anchors. You get that? So the welfare of the society or the amount of money you have in your bank account, these are sketchy anchors that never were promised to hold your weight. And all of James is about shifting from these categories to a new set of categories that is promised by Scripture to hold your joy. Amen? What's the purpose of today? It's a very practical one because James is practical, but it's intensely rich and deep as well. What's the purpose? To shift what you enjoy so that your contentment can be full for the rest of your lives. How many of you want to be happy? Okay, a lot of you don't want to be happy. Let's talk afterwards. We have four pastors. We may not have enough time, but we do need to talk if happiness is not a concern of yours. Now, James tells us that we are deeply discontent because our worldly sense of contentment depends upon things that were never designed to support the hopes and dreams that you have. So what James is doing is he's giving us five things that can actually hold your hope and your joy, and it can be stable enough for you to climb upon it. And so let's look at what that is. Let's go to verse 9 and 10, which is the start of our passage today. It says, "Let the lowly brother boast in his exaltation and the rich in his humiliation. Why? Because like a flower of the grass, he will pass away." Just like last week, James is basically saying, here's something you should do. Be content. Like, let there be boasting and let there be humiliation, but let there be boasting in all of that because, and the rest of this is all just a big why. Why? Why should you be content? And so, it says, let the lowly brother boast in his exaltation. In other words, celebrate with him. Like, let him enjoy the temporary success that he has right now if he was of a lowly economic status or another difficult circumstance. Why? Because it shows for all of us that poverty or illness or ill fate and suffering are not permanent conditions in this life. And so we say in another ways, every cloud has a silver lining. Good times do come. And so when a suffering brother does meet good circumstances, you should celebrate with him and exalt with him because that was not meant to last forever in this life and the next. And a similar counter-argument comes, also let the rich brother boast in his humiliation. Really interesting. It says, if you are well off during the times that you face rock bottom, boast in humiliation. Why? Why is it okay for both the poor brother to forget his suffering and the rich brother to be reminded of his suffering? Because both experiences of being either rich or poor are being substituted for eternal riches in Christ. That's where James is going right now. These are temporary conditions. And one of our greatest sources of dissatisfaction, why are we so discontent today, is because we have been living as if the temporary will last forever. Greatest source of discontentment is that we believe the things that we touch and hold on to right now will last forever. If it doesn't, you are put to shame. And if it does, there's something wrong with the metaphysical state of the world right now. So verse 11 and 12, at verse 11, let's go to verse 11. It says, for, and it's continuing with the reasoning, like think about why you can exalt in your temporary highness and boast in your temporary humiliation. Why is that? Because for the sun rises with the scorching heat and withers the grass, its flowers falls and its beauty perishes. So also will the rich man fade away in the midst of his pursuits. The wise man, according to James, sees life from a different vantage point, right? There is an end. There is an end to things. And this reminds the rich that although they are comfortable in this life, that life is temporary and passes away. And it makes you dive deeper than the shallowness of material possessions right now. It makes you go deeper because it will come to an end. In other words, whenever people are faced with a ultimatum, something that puts a stop to everything that is temporary or short-lived, that doesn't change, for example, things that don't and applies equally for all people, and some examples are time and death and taxes and God's kingdom. These are things that are ultimatums that put a stop to your earthly pursuits right now because you have to think about, will this last? Will this last forever? Whether it takes the form of poorness or richness. Scripture says that the ultimate reality that's coming is God's judgment and then his kingdom. Therefore, what's the conclusion? Be content with what you have for now because it doesn't determine your ultimate well-being. I'm going to repeat that once again because this needs to work in your heart in various different ways. Be content with what you have right now because it doesn't determine your ultimate well-being. Let's go to the next picture. And this is the first sketchy anchor versus the first real bomb-proof anchor that we want to look at today, which is the sketchy anchor is temporary riches. It won't hold the fullness of your weight or your expectations or your hopes. And the actual anchor is the coming kingdom of God, the eternal nature of it, and your value in it. And every point I have 5 points today, has a practical takeaway. Takeaway number one is that if you are a child of God, nothing on this earth during this life will satisfy you. And I hope, you know, I really wish we had the opportunity to invite, you know, Elon Musk, for example, to talk about this. Because it's like, no matter how rich you are always in the pursuit of something, more qualitatively, something different. And that's seen across history and all the demographics, once again, is true. If you are a child of God made in his image, this world will not satisfy you. In other words, if your joy depends on something you can touch right now, it is subject to inflation, is subject to depreciation, is subject to rot and moth eating, is subject to being stolen from you, is subject, just like the happiness percentage dropped from 31% to 14% in 2 years, that's what happens when your happiness depends upon circumstances that can be changed in 2 years. Recently, we had a very important Supreme Court decision come out, Dobbs, right? And if you are overly happy or if you are overly angry about that decision, what is that saying about your hope? Is your hope in how politics runs the world? Is your hope in a leader of this world? Then it's not meant to hold. You will fall. Your happiness will be shaky. And I pray, shift your joy to the kingdom of God. Amen? Amen? Your happiness needs to be in something that's eternal and not something that's temporary. We will enjoy the good gifts of God that he's given us in this earth, but it cannot depend upon it. Number two, let's go to verse 12. Blessed is a man who remains steadfast, remember what we talked about last week, steadfast, leading to perfection, under trial. For when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life, which God has promised to those who love him. Now, remember, testing your faith last week, it leads to steadfastness, which leads to perfection. And so, it's not, blessed is a man who is never tempted. It's not, blessed is a man who easily overcomes these things. It says, blessed is the one, it says in the NIV, endures temptation, goes through and suffers, and yet comes out steadfast. Why is this? Because it says, they will receive the crown of life, saved for them and promised for them for those who love God. Quick question. What is the crown of life then? Is it something worth looking forward to? If you look in the New Testament, there are five crowns that are talked about that is awarded to the final person who remains in the book of life. And so one of these five crowns, here James is talking about it and Revelation also talks about it. The crown of life is for all believers, especially though, for those who went to the point of death and suffering and yet overcame, who bravely confronted persecution for the sake of Jesus, even to the point of death, because the promise of eternal life. The crown of life, in other words, is a crown you receive when you have gone through the suffering of the world, trusting in Christ. Now, let's summarize this because there's a lot of meat in here. You see, any joy, it says here, it is promised to you. This crown of life is promised to you. And any joy that is going to be stable in the long run to sustain your hopes and desires must come from a what? A promise. It must come from a promise and not desires that you make out of yourself. And so we often try to tie our satisfaction to things that were never promised in Scripture. So for example, like here's a huge warning against health, wealth, and prosperity gospel. The belief that if you believe in Jesus, the rest of your life will be comfortable and rich. And many people come to church and I know when they say amen. For example, when I say, if you believe in Jesus, he has got you, you will be financially stable. I don't think I've ever said that before. But if you said amen right there, it shows what you're trying to get out of the Christian faith. But I tell you that richness and material wealth is not promised by Scripture. It's not a promise. And so here is something that you want, that the world says is good, but is unfounded upon God's word, but founded upon the desire, those things will give way when you try to climb up on it. And so let's look at the second picture. The next picture shows our second anchors. The sketchy anchor that will never hold you is unfounded promises. Promises that do not have an origin point. I was talking to a couple of brothers and sisters, young adults, and a huge theme that was coming out of this week was intimacy. And it's like, God's promising intimacy, so it's good to have intimacy. It's good to get married, right, Pastor? And I said, Scripture, when it talks about intimacy, when God talks about intimacy, is usually intimacy with him. He says, if you are in Christ, you will have access to the love of the Father and the Holy Spirit and the Son. That is the ultimate intimacy that is promised. And so he doesn't guarantee that you will have a family or a boyfriend or a girlfriend. And so if your hope relies upon getting married at the right time or getting the promotion at the right time, I'm just going to ask you, just one simple thing. I'm not going to rebuke you. I'm just going to ask you, can you find where that promise comes from in Scripture? Because if it is unfounded, it will give way. But the anchor that you should depend upon are the promises of God. Amen? Because God has never lied yet. All human beings that I know have lied at least a few times in their life, but God has never lied. His Old Testament promises and his covenants have been true until now. And so, God's promises are way more stable than your desires for yourself. And how to find contentment is to shift your anchor from what you desire to what is promised. You get that? What you desire to what is promised. What should be the automatic response to this? Lord, where does it say? Where do you promise this? Is this guaranteed? You start looking into Scripture to look for promises. Do you know that there are 7,487 promises to you? You know that? There was a person who, a pastor, who went through all of the Scripture, and every time there was a promise, he highlighted it. And then throughout his life, he would say true or false. T if it was fulfilled, false if it was not fulfilled. Every single highlight he had was fulfilled. And he lived his life according to promises. Now he was looking at highlighted sections that didn't have a true or false yet because it hadn't come yet. And he was saying, if it is true for the majority of everything that I've experienced, how much more so can I trust that this will also happen? For example, God will return. Amen? Like, that's a promise. He will bring justice to an unjust world. Amen? These are promises in Scripture, and if only you knew about it, your anchor would shift. It's not like Supreme Court legislation. No, God's legislation, God's kingdom is where you should cast your anchor. Then it is secure, and you have footing for your life because it's promises that have never been broken. Here's the practical takeaway from this part. How do you fight sin in this life? How do you combat desires that are unfounded? Because so many of the things that we desire and break our heart are things that don't have a foundation in Scripture. How do you overcome those? I joke every now and then. I hope that, you know, you understand what I'm saying. How do you break an addiction to smoking? Is to be addicted to a stronger substance like crack or cocaine. And gradually, lower substances become less addictive. How do you get weaned off of your fleshly desires? How do you get weaned off of that? By turning to the actual promises, the actual things that God says, if you are in Christ, this will belong to you. That's what you get addicted to. That's what you live for. And then your contentment will never crash because it's true. Verse 13 to 14 now. Let no one say when he is tempted, I am being tempted by God, for God cannot be tempted with evil, and he himself tempts no one, but each person is tempted. Why? When he is lured and enticed by his own desire. Then desire, there's a bait and switch happening now. It has conceived and gives birth to sin, and sin, when it's fully grown, brings forth death. The tendency to blame God is a huge reason why we are so discontent. God doesn't tempt. If God doesn't tempt according to today's word, then how then does temptation work? It says, each person is tempted when he is lured and trapped by his own desire. By his own desire. And so, like, why do people say God tempted me? Because they think that God says something to them that he never said, but it's actually their desire being put on God. God, you promised me no suffering in this world. And you're tempting me because now I feel suffering in this world. And the question is, when did God ever promise that? Isn't that your desire being projected onto God? Each person can only be tempted. In other words, Satan can only tempt you and then cause your joy to crash only when he has found something that is attractive to you in the first place. Do you get that? Satan can never touch you if he doesn't know what attracts you. And it's like fishing, you know? Bait. Why do we not have only one kind of bait, which is just worms? But why do we have so many different types of bait for different kinds of fish? Because different types of fish are attracted by different types of baits. They're attracted by different things. So the master fisher will have types of bait that attract different fish based on the season. And so what Satan is doing is, hey, like, money hasn't worked on you. Try this. It's like, Something else, whatever you're looking for right now, try this and let's see if you nibble on it. We are all drawn by what we are attracted to, and the master plan of Satan is to twist our attractions, right? And what's the catch? Like, we are so bombarded today with new temptations, new desires to pursue, and we're like fish running around everywhere because there's so many different types of appetizing bait. What's the catch? Why can't we nibble on it? Why can't we enjoy all the things that our flesh desires? Why is it? Because Satan's bait and switch is extremely dangerous. Because verse 15, it says, desire, like, is the bait is hiding a hook inside of it. And so the hook that desiring is hiding is sin that leads to death. Like, if he gets you out of the water, you will die. And that's the power of your attractions, your affections. It will lead to either life or death. And this is something that Satan tries to hide from us, the logical outcome of pursuing sin to your heart's delight. Every time we fulfill a fleshly desire, automatically what we get is a kick of dopamine or a high of self-affirmation or the spotlight of feeling relevant or good about yourself, right? It seems like only good things happen when I take advantage of and indulge my temptations without ever knowing that we are running towards a cliff by pursuing sin and death. The logical outcome of so many of our desires, if it is not founded upon God's word, is death and sin. And if only we had the pair of glasses to see that reality. How many of us are running towards a cliff? The third comparison of anchors that we want to switch towards, let's look at the next picture. It is fleshly desires to spiritual and heavenly desires. Wanting different things. Practical takeaway is that my prayer for you as a pastor, my biggest prayer, is the first sermon that I gave to you when I was interviewing for this church. Does anyone remember what I preached on that day, 2 years ago? For you to have a new heart that desires good things, right? It's like, okay, I know that vegetables are better for me than meat, red meat, but the desire is still for the meat and not the vegetables. And the greatest paradox that we have is that we know what is good and we don't love what is good. And so the two coming together, like what I want to see in my congregation is the Holy Spirit regenerating your heart and your affections so that you cry out things like, Lord, I want to serve your church. I want holiness. It's not like, I know I have to be holy, so I'm not going to do this. No, that is a losing battle because you want something that you are depriving yourself of. I want you to want what is good and right. You know, listen to this. This is very important. These three are tragic situations that we always find ourselves in. Three scenarios. You desire something, but you don't get it. That's scenario number one. You desire something, but you don't get it. That's a tragedy. Tragedy number two. You desire something and you get it, but the thing that you got is not good for you. Like children having candy all the time. The parent would not allow that child to have candy because it is bad for the kids and their teeth. And the final tragic scenario, you don't desire something, but you get it anyways. How many of these things characterize our daily walk in Christ in the world? Like, you want something, and you discover there's a hook in it. It's like, what do I do now? You don't want something, and God is saying, you know, I invite you to a life with me. I want you to love me. I want to love you. And we're like, not attractive, but that's ultimately good. What do you do? I'm praying, Lord, give them a new heart with new taste buds that are attracted by good things of the world and of God. That's my prayer for you. Amen. May you have a new heart with new desires. And then the Christian life becomes the easiest thing ever. Here's a quick question. Pastor, how do I know? I'm expecting people to take this word seriously, and they're probably going to interact with this throughout the week. And there's a question I'm thinking is going to come out. Pastor, how do I know what a legitimate desire is versus a fleshly desire? How can I differentiate between that? Because many of you love your children. Amen? You love your spouse, right? Okay. Is that good or bad? Good or bad, only if something has happened. Only if you love God more than loving your family is beautiful. If you love your family more than God, disastrous. That's what we call idolatry. Think of this. The center of our galaxy is the sun. And the sun rightly deserves to be there because the sun has enough mass and gravity to hold it in place like this. And everything finds its orbit with the mass of the sun in the middle. And imagine if you're so selfish that you're saying the earth has to be in the middle of the universe, in the middle of the galaxy, everything flies out and nothing makes sense anymore. Here is what it is. The order of your affections is crucial, right? Like, it's okay if you love gaming, but if you love gaming more than your child, the child will starve to death while you play games. Do you see how the affection and the order of it is important? And so what I'm saying is, if heavenly desires are your first desire, your other desires find legitimate place and purpose. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. Christians, I don't want you to go home and feel guilty when you invest in your family saying, I should be a missionary somewhere. No, I should be, you know, a pastor somewhere. I should be serving the church right now. No, your desire is in the right place if you love God. If you love God first and you say, Lord, you are first in my life, whom I have in heaven but you, right? If that's your confession, all of your loves will find the proper place. All of your affections and hobbies will find the right place. Amen? Amen. Verse 16 and 17. Let's go to the next slide. Do not be deceived, brothers. Every good and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. The gifts we give to ourselves and our flesh lead to sin and death, and they always shake. They're always unstable. But a father gives you good gifts. A good father gives you good gifts. The word father of lights is used only once in Scripture in the book of James. And we need more usages of this term to understand what this means. But based upon this context, the father of lights most accurately refers to a God who is the source and the standard of goodness and beauty. And so light shines upon the world. That's how we're able to see. And so darkness is simply an absence of light. Do you get that? Like, cold is an absence of heat and energy. And so when it says God is a father of lights, it's saying he is the source and the standard. He gives good gifts, and because he gives it, that's why it is good, even suffering. So every good and perfect gift, even if it comes in the form of poorness or richness, it is a good and perfect gift because it comes from the standard and the source. I had another conversation where I talked about this. I'm finding myself talking about this more and more. It's like, and somebody was asking, why does God want all the glory for himself? Why is he so selfish? Why does he need to be the center of the universe? And I told him, okay, Scripture says God is life. So if you walk away from life, where are you going? Death. If you walk away from truth, you're going to get lies. If you walk away from beauty, you're going to get ugliness. And so why does God deserve to be glorified and in the center as the Father of lights? Because he defines what you're looking for, and you will not get the gift without the giver. You will not get the gift without the giver. You will not have Christmas presents without a fatherly figure in your life. And so many of you are looking for money and satisfaction and promotions and everything that the world throws at you without a giver. And a really smart child knows, hey, I know I want gummy bears. I'm talking about my children now. I want gummy bears. I want entertainment. But I've noticed if I stick by my father, it comes for free. That is a smart child processing things. And if you are a smart Christian, where does your contentment come from? Being next to the Father. Amen? Why are you going out there looking for things that only come from the Father? And that's the original sin. We wanted the fruit, and we wanted to be like God and not with God. We have been against this relationship from the start. No wonder we're running around looking for things that only He can give. Here is my promise of how you get satisfaction and contentment in this life. Have a relationship with the Lord. Amen? Know who God is. Let God know you and love you. And that is the source of all good things coming down from the Father of light. And then everything turns into a good or a perfect gift. That is the confidence that I want my congregation to have. Why? Because in God, there is no variation. There's no shadow. There's no change. God will remain a good Father. And I'm going to go into a little logical thinking now. Your image of God the Father is crucial to what you expect out of Him. If you were born and raised under an abusive father, you might expect abuse coming out of your heavenly Father as well. And so your image of God is extremely important to how happy you are. So let's look at the fourth slide. Your fourth anchor, you have to shift it from an inaccurate perception of God. Like some people say, oh God, he's scary, or he's jealous, or he's a whimsical dictator, he's a tyrant. You have to shift that to an accurate biblical view of God, which says He is holy, He loves you, He is perfect, He doesn't change, He will not fail you. He proved His goodness by giving you His Son. And so if you shift your anchor to that, correctly knowing God, you will be happy forever. Contentment doesn't come from having more stuff, but from having a renewed understanding and vision of a never-changing Father, from Him whom all blessings flow. Know the Father. Know the Father. Spend time in your book. Spend time in prayer. Spend time in communion. You must know your Father to change how you see the world and how you see reality. Verse 18, the last verse today. Of His own will, of a good Father's will, of His will He brought us forth by the word of truth, that we should be a kind of first fruits of His creatures. It says, what kicked off this whole plan of redemption and sanctification and glorification, all the things that we are in store for right now, what kicked it off? By His will. God's will kicked off by the word of truth, all the things that we will see coming in the future. Our growth in Christ, our maturity, our love for one another, the victory of the church over sin and death in the future, the wiping away of all tears when God's kingdom comes. What kicked it off? The will of God and not your plan. Anchor number five. Let's look at the picture. The sketchy anchor that we have is our own plans and desires. Can we get that? Your own will and plans cause you suffering. There are many people saying, Pastor, I need to retire by this age. And if that's your plan, you will be let down in so many different ways. Because your will comes from an incomplete mind, a non-omniscient mind, a non-omnipotent power. You have lack of resources. You don't know the future. Therefore, your plans will always fail unless God upholds it. So how do you shift your anchor for happiness? God's will, God's plan. Amen? God's will and God's plan must be victorious. Our contentment often comes from my plan being fulfilled. Gotta graduate, gotta find a job, find a spouse, have children, retire by a certain time frame, or else I'm not in control of my life. And so much of our contentment comes from my ability to control my life. And what we often do is, okay, I'm noticing I'm lacking control now. Like, my children aren't listening. Gotta go to church now. I think financially I'm gonna suffer. Gotta go to church now because God's gonna help me fulfill my plan. That's why you're unhappy, because you're using God to fulfill your plans. But the greatest security, the greatest hope, the greatest security comes from knowing that your will and your plans are being conformed to God's will for your life. Is there an amen to that? Your life is being conformed to God's will. And this is where the image of your father is so important. If he's a bad God, and you know, the greatest lie Satan has ever told is that if you obey God and listen to him, he will make your life miserable. How many of you still think that? That if you obey God and let's say you sign up to be a missionary, or you say, and that's not biblical, by the way, like there's so many other ways to serve God. You don't have to go to seminary. Here's the thing though. Let's say if I give my life to God, he will make sure that I don't have pleasure in this life. Who told you that? But a twisted view of God. And so when I say God's will take care of your life, how many of you are afraid? Because it means no more alcohol, no more this, no more that, no more that. Your father gives you good and perfect gifts that override your attachment to the things of the earth. So when God's will is recognized, our satisfaction is perfect. Let's look at this Bible verse together. Let's read it all together, actually. 1 John 2:17, very short verse. Ready? 1, 2, 3. The world is passing away along with its desires. Whoever does the will of God remains forever. Amen. Amen. This is the word of God. I'm not filtering this out through my words. God's word says this. So, what does that mean for us today as a practical takeaway? How many of you know the will of God for you? Right? Do you know the will of God for you? It's in Scripture, right? How many of you know what God wants from you from this hour? Like this hour, 60 minutes is going to pass by. God probably has a will for you right now. Do you know what it is? How do you know this? Scripture, prayer. Scripture, communion and fellowship. Scripture, prayer. How can we be happy to know God's will for us so that we can obey it and then there will be satisfaction? And the biggest issue is that we don't go to our scripture sometimes and we forget what the will of God is. And the scary part is we substitute God's will for my will. And so I want this, my plan is that, and that's where all the discontentment comes from. Make a daily practice out of discerning and then submitting to God's will in Scripture. Amen? Let's do that. So in summary, let's look at the fifth picture once again, the five anchors all over again. How can we be content? By moving from shakable anchors to bomb-proof anchors. Temporary riches to God's kingdom. Unfounded promises to God's promises. Notice everything on the right side is under and of God. It comes from God. That's why it's unshakable. Fleshly desires versus God's own desires in the spirit. Fickle dictator, like an image of God, an imprecise image of God to an unchanging Father. Your will to God's will. Shift it to the Lord. Your life will be stable. And that's how we will be content for the rest of our lives. When we see the gospel, Jesus was the happiest, most content man in the world. Listen to how all this plays out. When Satan promised him, if you kneel down before me, I'm going to give you the world. Jesus knew that that was temporary, and he looked to God's kingdom and said no to that. Jesus always recalled what? The promises of God for his ministry. He would always quote Isaiah or Psalms, and he would quote scripture because that was what would sustain him in life and ministry. He was fueled not by fleshly desires, but by heavenly desires. He said this, my food is to do the will of God who sent me and to finish that work. That's his desire, heavenly desires. Like, I wish all of you next year, like, your greatest desire would be to see someone saved. Amen? Like, that's a heavenly desire right there, to see someone accept the gospel and be saved. Our hearts need to change like that. And Jesus didn't see God as a whimsical tyrant. He saw God as a father, an unchanging and good father. And therefore, he was able to say what? Not according to my will, but Father, according to your will, may it be done. Your will be done. Your will be done. So Jesus was the most content man in the world. He was our lead. He climbed up first, and his job was to find secure places in the world to hang our hope upon, and he calls down to the people under us, under him, and he's saying to all followers, hey, this is a sketchy foundation. Don't trust in money for your happiness. And he says to us, I have found a bomb-proof foundation. It is the gospel. It is the cross. It is a relationship with me. It is the word of truth. That is where you should hang your life upon for you to be satisfied even if you are being killed. He whispers us today, even today as we are climbing, do you see the cross? This is a bomb-proof anchor. And you can hang on it with all your might for all your satisfaction, and it will never fail you. In fact, I told you this about three times so far. I'm going to tell it to you one more time. When I went to JAMA, which is a Christian conference, I think it was for youth kids, when I went there, there was an old Jesuit priest. And this is what he prayed for us. All of us in middle school and high school, we wanted to become things. We wanted to have a certain occupation. And we had dreams. We had dreams. And this is what he prayed for us, and I hated it back then. He said, may all the ropes that you hang on snap and break until you fall upon the rock, which is Jesus Christ. Then you will never need to climb again. And that changed me from the inside out. Joy is not a climbing game. It's not supposed to depend upon how strong your muscles are. You won't get too far. Joy is about an unshakable foundation that will hold you no matter how far you fall. It is Christ. He is called the rock for a reason. If you fall upon him, your joy will be complete just as his joy was complete, and you do not have to find yourself struggling to get up that ladder again, struggling to find a place to rest in, struggling to find a joy and a compassion. No. Jesus is your rock. You will not fall lower than him if you believe in him. Amen. Then the whole journey of life isn't about how strong you are. It's about how strong is the God who lifts you up. There you have freedom, joy. You can relax. You can focus on your mental health for a while because it's not going to depend on you. Your Father has got your back. May that be your bomb-proof joy today, your bomb-proof anchor for your deep contentment now and forevermore. That's my blessing to you. Amen. Praise team, can you please come up? Let's spend just about 30 seconds in prayer before we worship today. And I want you to visualize. Visualizing is very powerful. Can you see where you hang your hope upon, where you hang your joy upon? Let's take some time to move that into a gospel-centeredness. and to Christ himself. So please take some time in silence to evaluate where your heart is right now. What do you hope in? What makes you happy? Don't let it be the factors that the Gallup poll asked, but let it be factors that are found in Scripture now. And that will sustain our joy. Let's pray. Father, give us a hope that lasts beyond generations, that lasts beyond circumstances. Don't let our hope be subject to inflation or be subject to political change or be subject to economical change. But Father, may our hope be as real as a cross is real. May our hope be as deep as God is deep. May our hope be as joyful as the gospel is joyful. Bless your congregation. Bless your people, Father. Let's rise and sing in response. Do you desire happiness and contentment? Yes? Amen? Okay. Let's sing.
Oh.
Let's glorify God. And the words and the lyrics of that song are my benediction to you. May God be your vision forever. May Jesus be the foundation upon which you are able to claim, I am satisfied forever. May the Holy Spirit remind you of the anchors of your heart that are strong enough to hold and will never fluctuate over time. May this triune God, the Father of lights, the giver of good and perfect gifts, be upon you and your children and all those who climb up after you this game of life, that they would know what is stable, what is pure, what is true, now and forevermore. And all of God's people responded with a resounding yes and amen. Amen. Let's give glory to the Lord. If you could all be seated, and our new members, please come to the front. We'll try to do this expediently. We have beautiful new members who are home to that have decided to call KCPC their home. I have the lineup. I have questions for you. Now, please turn to me, and I have questions to ask you. The following questions are the basic vows for membership in a PCA church, including KCPC. And these are the questions I will ask. Please respond with a yes or an amen. Do you acknowledge yourselves to be sinners in the sight of God, justly deserving His displeasure, and without hope, save in His sovereign mercy? Do you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ as the Son of God and the Savior of sinners, and do you receive and rest upon Him alone for salvation, as is offered in the Scriptures, in the Gospel? Do you now resolve and promise, in humble reliance upon the grace of the Holy Spirit, that you will endeavor to live as becomes His follower of Christ? Amen. And do you promise to support the church in its worship and work to the best of your ability? Do you submit yourself to the government and the discipline of the church and promise to promote its peace and purity? Amen. You can turn around now. Congregation, if you can raise your right hand, we're going to put them together pretty soon, and repeat say yes or amen to this question. Do you promise to love, uphold, and hold these people accountable for the purpose of helping them grow as disciples of Jesus Christ, while in the meantime bearing their burdens and sharing their joy? Yes and amen. Beloved members, we extend the right hand of fellowship to you and welcome you to KCPC. Let's thank the Lord for their joining. Okay. If you've noticed, our membership classes are getting better and better every year. So we actually have a luncheon afterwards. Please, if you're a leader in our church, come and say hello and welcome them into the church. Okay, you may walk back. Thank you, everyone. Thank you. Also, one quick announcement on my part. I have been receiving many requests to do premarital or marital counseling. I will be doing that now in class format. And so we're planning to have about 4 to 5 couples start all at once together. And so we're going to be starting this July 2nd or 3rd, this coming Saturday at 12:30 at The Well. And so if you're ever interested in premarital or marital counseling, please join us at The Well at 12:30 on Saturday. Thank you. In the darkness, we
Hello. All right. Well, good morning. Welcome to all those of you who are new and anyone who is visiting for the first time. Welcome to KCPC. We're glad that you were able to join us. Please, if you can make your way to the back where after service, after we conclude, there will be welcoming team members there to welcome you and to connect you to our church. So just wanted to say that. Any of you who are college students, say yes, sir. Yes, sir. All right. Let me grab your attention real quick. College students, please just pay attention just real quick. We do have community group every week, Tuesdays and Wednesday. You can sign up as usual. This Friday, July 1st, first day of July, the month of July, we're going to have a large group on Friday at the Well, 6 p.m. Dinner will be provided, but we ask that you would please RSVP on Facebook event as early as possible so that we can have enough food for you. So we encourage you to come out this upcoming Friday. We're going to be doing an event called Holiday in July. So we're going to be actually trading mugs through an event called White Elephant. Right? Everybody know what White Elephant is, right? We do that usually in Christmas, but we're going to do that in July. Also, we're going to be painting some eggs, I think, because we weren't able to do that for Easter. So we're going to do that for this upcoming Friday. So this Friday at the Well, 6 p.m., dinner provided, RSVP on Facebook event. Thank you.
All right. Thanks, Pastor John. This past Sunday, one of our brothers, Pastor Michael Koo, received his ordination. Could we just give him a round of applause? Pastor Mike has an announcement to share with us.
Good morning, KCPC. Thank you for that applause. I'm glad that you're all here this morning. I just wanted to share a quick announcement today. It's about our Awana ministry, which currently meets on Wednesday evenings from 7:15 to 9 p.m. every Wednesday here. So our Awana ministry is a ministry that is really here to reach all of our children here in this church with the gospel through our Bible memorization, through our small groups, through our game times even, through our fellowship, and all things in between. And so we are currently open for registration for those of you with children who would be interested in sending your children for Awana. Again, Wednesdays from 7:15 to 9 p.m. here at KCPC. But also, we are also looking for volunteers. And so if you have a heart for our children, our precious, precious children who've been running around everywhere this past week for VBS, if you've seen them, those children are in need of volunteers to lead them, to guide them to Christ through Awana. And so if you are interested, please go on out to our KCPC website where you can find our Awana page. We'll have children's registrations and volunteer registration forms up on that page. So please pray about it and please come on out to join us for Awana. Thank you all.
Thanks, Pastor Michael. We also have an MTW East Coast Missions Conference. MTW stands for Mission to the World. It's called Gather to Scatter to the Ends of the Earth. It's in person only, taking place July 8th to 9th at KCPC. The conference is free to attend, but registration is required. For more information and to register, please visit that website. Also, we have another beautiful ministry called Young Adult Ministry, YAM. YAM Lunch Buddies. Complete the Google form, the QR code right there, to let us know if you're interested. Our next praise and prayer night is on July 15th. Mark your calendars. With that, thank you so much. I hope everybody has a great week, and please continue to enjoy your fellowship outside of our worship sanctuary. Thank you.
How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. For I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. Hallelujah.